What Einstein Didn't Know: Scientific Answers to Everyday Questions by Robert L. Wolke. Narrated by Sean Runnette. Copyright 1997 by Robert L. Wolke. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Robert L. Wolke, care of Ethan Ellenberg Literary Agency, and was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction. Forget the word science. This book simply tells you what's going on beneath the surface of everyday things. It is for people who are curious about the world around them, but who don't have the time to seek out the explanations or may be a bit intimidated by science. Of course, the answers to why everyday things happen must be scientific. That is, logical and accurate. But you won't find the usual pop science non-answers here that leave you just as mystified as before. Instead of mere answers, you will be given explanations. Plain talk that I hope will lead you all the way to genuine, well, I'll be darned, understanding. Traditionally, people have encountered science in four places: classrooms, textbooks, children's books, and in deadly serious tomes by solemn scientists. Unfortunately, science classrooms and textbooks have turned off at least as many people as they have turned on. Don't get me started. The fun books for kids are great, but they promote the false notion that only kids can be curious about things. And the solemn science books only perpetuate the conviction that science is inherently incomprehensible to ordinary mortals. This is not a textbook. It is far from solemn, and it is not a fun book for kids. But don't be surprised if your kids steal it from you. It is a fun book for grown-ups. But it is not a collection of gee whiz facts to be marveled at and instantly forgotten. Instead, it answers real questions that might be asked by real people in real situations. Around the house, in the kitchen, in the garage, in the marketplace, and in the great outdoors. As you listen, you'll hear a number of try-its, tests and demonstrations that you can do yourself, whether seated at your kitchen table or on an airplane. You will also hear a number of bar bets that may or may not win you a round of drinks, but will certainly spark a lively discussion. Throughout the book, whenever an explanation threatens to become more than you want to know, the details are prefaced by Nitpicker's Corner for easy skipping. Occasional technical buzzwords are explained when they are used. Molecule is just about the only technical buzzword that is absolutely unavoidable in explaining your everyday surroundings. You may already have a pretty good idea of what a molecule is, but for the purposes of this book, here is all you need to know. A molecule is one of those invisibly tiny particles that everything is made of. All the things that you see and touch are different because their molecules are of different kinds, sizes, shapes, and arrangements. Molecules are made of clusters of even tinier particles called atoms. There are about 100 different kinds of atoms, and they can combine in an enormous variety of ways to form an enormous number of kinds of molecules. As Keats might have put it, "That is all ye know on earth, and all ye need to know, going in." Happy understandings. 1. Around the house. Let's just wander about the house for a while. If we have our antennas up, we'll find a wealth of fascinating things to look into. Perhaps candles are burning on the dining table, and the champagne is bubbling away while we admire a sunset through the picture window. Or maybe we're stuck down in the laundry, where soap and bleach are working their chemical magic on all that ooky stuff that we lump under the general heading of dirt. In this section, we'll learn what astounding things are going on in the candles, the champagne, the sunset, the soap, and the bleach, not to mention the waterbed and the shower. Here's the dirt on soap. They say there are three things you don't want to see being made: sausage, laws, and soap. I've already heard too much about legislators, and I'd rather not know about sausage. But I'll brace myself. How do they make soap? the unholy mess involved in making soap belies its use as an incomparable cleaner of just about everything for at least the past 2,000 years. It has always been easy to make out of cheap, readily available materials, fat and wood ashes. Lime was sometimes used also. You can make it the way the Romans did. Heat limestone to make lime. Sprinkle wet lime onto hot wood ashes and mix well. Shovel the resulting gray sludge into a cauldron of hot water and boil it up with chunks of goat fat for several hours. When a thick layer of dirty brown curd forms on the surface and hardens upon cooling, cut it into cakes. That's your soap. Or, if you prefer, just go to the store and buy a cake of today's highly purified commercial product. In addition to soap, which is a definite chemical compound, it probably contains fillers, dyes, perfumes, deodorants, antibacterial agents, various creams and lotions, and lots of advertising. Sometimes more advertising than soap. Every soap is made by the reaction of a fat with an alkali, a strong, potent base. A base is the opposite of an acid. Instead of goat fat, today's soaps are made from any of a number of different fats, including beef and lamb tallow, and the oils of palm, cottonseed, and olive. Castile soap is made from olive oil. The alkali used in making today's soap is usually lye, caustic soda, or sodium hydroxide. Lime is another handy alkali, while wood ashes can still be used in a pinch because they contain the alkali potassium carbonate. Having been created by the addition of an organic compound, a fatty acid, to an inorganic compound, lye, the soap molecule retains some features of both its parents. It has an organic end that likes to fraternize with oily organic substances, and an inorganic end that is attracted to water. Hence its incomparable ability to coax oily dirt into the wash water. Whenever you see the following chemicals listed as ingredients on the label of a shampoo, toothpaste, shaving cream, or cosmetic, be neither alarmed nor impressed. They're all just the chemical names of soaps. Sodium stearate, sodium oleate, sodium palmitate, sodium myristate, sodium laurate, sodium tallowate, and sodium cocoate. If the sodium is replaced by potassium, the soap has been made with caustic potash, potassium hydroxide, instead of with caustic soda, lye, or sodium hydroxide. Potassium soaps are softer and may even be liquids. Cleanliness is next to impossible. Whenever there is something in our bodies, clothes, or cars that we don't like, we say they are dirty and we wash them. What we call dirt can be any kind of stuff at all. But soap always seems to oblige us by removing it, and only it. How does the soap know what's dirt? It would appear that soap is a magic substance that recognizes and respects our skins and precious possessions while devouring everything else under the sun like a vulture, leaving only bones behind. But no such magic substance exists. Instead, the answer has to do with the natures of oil and water. Simplistic as it may sound, everything that we call dirt, more politely, foreign substance, is either oily or is stuck to us with oil. And soap is a uniquely good oil remover. Before we can figure out how to remove dirt, we must look at how we get dirty in the first place. A microscopic speck of dirt, meaning anything we don't want attached to us, can be stuck on in one of two ways. Either it is mechanically trapped in a microscopic crevice, or else it is moist, and the moisture makes it adhere. An example of the former is the kind of dirty you get on a dusty road. An example of the latter is the kind you get on a muddy one. In either case, a good hosing down with plain water, encouraged perhaps by a little rubbing, will do a reasonable job of removing the foreign substances. Soap isn't really necessary. But what if the dirt particles have a slightly oily coating instead of a watery one? They will stick to your skin just as the wet mud did. In fact, the dirt doesn't even have to bring along its own oily coating. There is often enough oil on our skins to make the dirt particles stick. Unlike the mud, however, this dirt is going to stay stuck, because oil doesn't evaporate and dry up as water does. Nor will a spray of plain water dislodge it, because water won't have anything to do with oil. It will simply roll off the dirt as it would off a duck's back, which, as you know, is covered with oily feathers. It seems, then, that the only thing we can do to unstick oil-adhering dirt is to seek and destroy the sticky oil itself. The dirt will then be able to fall off or be swept away by a liquid. Well then, let's fill the old bathtub with alcohol, kerosene, or gasoline. They're all good solvents for oil, aren't they? That's what dry cleaners do to our dirty clothes. They tumble them around in a barrel full of a solvent such as perchloroethylene, or PERC for short, an organic solvent that is a phenomenal dissolver of oil. They call the process dry cleaning, in spite of the fact that it involves sloshing things around in a very wet liquid. The thinking seems to be that if it isn't water, it isn't wet. Wrong, of course. Unfortunately, PERC in the bathtub would kill you even faster than the alcohol, kerosene, or gasoline would, so we can forget about bathing in solvents. But there is one substance that is just as good, and it's not very toxic. Mouths have reportedly been washed out with it. Soap. Soap doesn't actually dissolve oil. It accomplishes the astounding feat of enticing the oil into the water, so that the oil and its captive specks of dirt can then be flushed away. Soap molecules are long and stringy. For almost all of their length, the tail, they are exactly the same as oil molecules, and therefore have an affinity for other oil molecules. But at one end, the head, they have a pair of electrically charged atoms that just love to associate with water molecules. And this head is what drags the whole soap molecule into the water, makes it dissolve. While swimming around in the water, if a gang of dissolved soap molecules encounters an oily particle of dirt, their oil-loving tails will latch onto the oil, while their water-loving heads are still firmly anchored in the water. The result is that the oil is pulled into the water. Its captive dirt particle is released from whatever it was stuck to, and it can be swept down the drain. Nitpicker's Corner. There is a second important thing that soap does. It makes water wetter. That is, it helps the water to penetrate into all the nooks and crannies of whatever it is we're washing. Water molecules stick to each other quite strongly. As a result, a water molecule situated at the surface of a piece of water has very strong attractions that are trying to pull it into the rest of the piece. Now, the tightest huddling together formation that any group of particles can achieve is to gather into a spherical shape. A sphere has the smallest possible amount of surface exposed to the outside world. That's why water forms spherical drops whenever it is free to do so, such as when it is falling as rain. In two dimensions, that's why the pioneers circled the wagons against the Indians. If they had squared the wagons, they would have been exposing more of themselves to the outside. This inward pulling force on the surface molecules of a liquid is called surface tension. It arises because the surface molecules are, in a way, different from the molecules in the body of the liquid. In the body of a liquid, a molecule is pulled upon by attractions to fellow molecules above, below, and all around it, and these pulls cancel each other out. But a molecule right on the surface is pulled upon only from below and all around, but not from above. So there is a net downward pull, uncancelled by any upward pull. This makes the surface molecules adhere more tightly to the water than the other molecules do. And the water behaves as if it had a taut skin on its surface. Small objects can even lie on the surface without sinking through the skin, and water bugs can even skate merrily along on the water's surface. Enter soap. Soap molecules disrupt the surface tension of water by crowding around the water surface with their water-loving heads in the water and their oil-loving tails sticking out. This disrupts the huddling together tendency of the water molecules and allows them to pay some attention to, that is, adhere to and wet, other things, including a floating needle. Try it. Because of surface tension, you can rest a steel sewing needle on the surface of water in a bowl. Lower it down carefully with a couple of toothpicks or matchsticks. After you've gotten the needle to rest on the water's surface, sprinkle some powdered laundry detergent near it, but don't actually bomb it. Detergents are even better than soap at killing surface tension. As soon as some of the detergent dissolves, the needle will plunge precipitously to Davy Jones's locker. Love boat logic. A TV commercial for a Caribbean cruise line says, "For our guests who may have been out in the sun too long, we even wash our sheets in soft water." Is that for real? No. The advertising copywriter has been out in the sun too long. Makes you wonder whether a cruise line that swallows this kind of foolishness from its advertising agency is capable of finding the right islands. Rather than insulting my listeners by pointing out why the sheets will not be any softer, I might gently remind any prospective cruisers among you that hard and soft water are not called that because of their relative rigidities. Nor is it because you make hard-boiled eggs with one and soft-boiled eggs with the other. The choice of hard and soft as sobriquets for these waters was unfortunate. They would better have been called difficult and cooperative, with respect to soap. Hard water is water that has been around the block. It first fell through the air as rain, and then frolicked and percolated over, around, and through the rocks and rills before being apprehended, detained, and exploited by humans. In its peregrinations, it inevitably picked up carbon dioxide from the air, which made it acid. Carbonic acid. This acid can dissolve small amounts of calcium and magnesium-bearing rocks, such as limestone, calcium carbonate, and dolomite, mixed calcium and magnesium carbonates. It can also dissolve certain iron-bearing minerals slightly. As a result, the water can wind up containing dissolved minerals such as calcium, magnesium, and iron. It is considered hard because it is hard for soap to do its job properly in water that contains these minerals. Soap consists of long molecules that have an oil-loving end and a water-loving end. It does its cleaning job primarily by joining oil and water together. The trouble is that calcium, magnesium, and iron react with the water-loving ends of these molecules to form insoluble, white, waxy curds that effectively remove the soap from the water and prevent it from doing its job. These curds are evident as soap scum, or in their most infamous guise, bathtub ring. Contrary to folklore, the latter is more a sign of the hardness of the water than of the hygienic habits of the bather. Incidentally, here is our candidate for the most disquieting thought of the week. You have probably eaten soap scum in certain candies. One common form of soap scum goes by the chemical name of magnesium stearate. The stearate part comes from the soap, while the magnesium part comes from the hard water. Magnesium stearate is a soft, smooth, waxy substance. That's what makes it stick to the bathtub, all right. But that's also why it imparts a creamy texture to soft mints and other suckable candies. A soapy texture, if we may be so bold. If you see magnesium stearate listed among the ingredients of your candy, be assured that it is the pure chemical compound, manufactured from sources quite different from bathtub scrapings. But back to the hard water. We can do two things about soap's inability to perform its job well in hard water. We can soften the water, or we can lose the soap and use a synthetic detergent instead. Water softening tactics are based upon removing the offending minerals or rendering them ineffective. Many home water softening units remove the minerals by ion exchange. Ion exchangers replace the calcium at all with sodium, which is innocuous because it is already a part of the soap molecule. In what seems like ancient times, about 50 years ago, hard water was combated by adding washing soda, sodium carbonate, to the laundry tub. This chemical reforms the original insoluble calcium and magnesium carbonates, essentially the original rock, thereby removing them before they can gum up the soap. These days, however, practically nobody uses soap for laundry. The acres of wash day products on the supermarket shelves are all synthetic detergents, and are all essentially identical, except for the hype. Like soap, they have oil-loving and water-loving ends on their molecules, but they simply refuse to react with calcium and magnesium. For good measure, they usually contain water-softening chemicals such as phosphates, and guess what? Washing soda. Hard water is still a villain, however, because it can clog up water pipes and boilers. When hard water is boiled, the dissolved calcium and magnesium fall back out of the water as limestone and dolomite. This born-again rock, called boiler scale, can form a tenacious coating on the insides of boilers, water heaters, and pipes, clogging them up like the arteries of a Viennese pastry chef. If your water supply is hard, shine a flashlight inside your dry tea kettle and you'll see the boiler scale as a white coating on the surface. If it bothers you, boil some vinegar and acid in the kettle to dissolve it. Try it. Shake up a few shavings of bar soap or a few flakes of ivory snow, which is real soap, with some distilled water in a jar. You'll get a beautiful thick head of suds, indicating that the soap is doing its job. Distilled water is pure and free of minerals. You can find it in many supermarkets and drugstores. Next, if you live in a hard water area, add some tap water and shake again. If your water supply is soft, you can simulate hard water by adding a little milk instead. The calcium in the hard water, or milk, will kill the suds flat. You may even see some soap scum in the form of floating white curds. Burning a candle at one end. When a candle burns, where does the wax go? Except for what drips all over your tablecloth, it goes to the same place that gasoline and oil go when they burn, into the air, but in a chemically altered form. Candles are usually made of paraffin, which is a mixture of hydrocarbons, the substances that we find in petroleum. As the name implies, hydrocarbon molecules contain nothing but hydrogen atoms and carbon atoms. When they burn, they react with oxygen in the air. The carbon and oxygen become carbon dioxide, while the hydrogen and oxygen become water. Both of these products are gases at the temperature of the flame, and they just go off into the air. We burn many other hydrocarbons: methane in natural gas, propane in gas grills and torches, butane in cigarette lighters, kerosene in lamps, and gasoline in cars. They all burn to form carbon dioxide and water vapor and seem to disappear in the process. Paper, wood, and coal contain additional mineral and plant materials that don't burn, so besides producing carbon dioxide and water, they leave an ash. Nitpicker's Corner. When there isn't quite enough oxygen available to make a full complement of carbon dioxide, as in an automobile engine, we get some carbon monoxide also. If you find it hard to believe that flames produce water, try this. Try it. Put some ice cubes in a small, thin aluminum saucepan, let it get cold, and hold it just over the flame of a candle or a butane cigarette lighter. After a while, check the bottom of the pan and you'll see that water vapor from the flame has condensed there into liquid water. You didn't ask, but why won't a candle burn without a wick? By capillary action, the wick leads melted wax up to where it can be vaporized and mix with oxygen in the air. A block of solid wax, or even a puddle of melted wax, won't burn because the wax molecules can't come in contact with enough oxygen molecules. Only as vapors can they mix intimately, molecule for molecule, and react. Combustion, burning, is a reaction that releases heat energy. Once it begins, it gives off more than enough heat to keep melting and vaporizing more wax to keep the process going. Fire. The flames in my gas grill are blue, but the candles on the dinner table burn with a yellow flame. What makes flames different colors? It's a matter of how much oxygen is available to the burning fuel. Lots of oxygen makes blue flames, while a limited amount of oxygen makes yellow ones. Let's look at the yellow flame first. A candle is really a very complex flame-producing machine. First, some of the wax must melt, then the liquid wax must be carried up the wick, then it must be vaporized to a gas, and only then can it burn, react with oxygen in the air to form carbon dioxide and water vapor. This is far from an efficient process. If the burning were 100% efficient, the wax would be transformed completely into invisible carbon dioxide and water. But the flame can't get all the oxygen it needs to do that just by taking it out of the air in its immediate vicinity. The air, with its flame-nourishing cargo of oxygen, just can't flow in fast enough to take care of all the melted and vaporized paraffin that is ready to burn. So, under the influence of the heat, some of the unburnable paraffin breaks down into tiny particles of carbon, among other things. These particles are heated by the flame and become luminous. They glow with a bright yellow light. And that's what makes the flame yellow. By the time the glowing carbon particles reach the top of the flame, almost all of them have found enough oxygen to burn themselves out. The same thing happens in kerosene lamps, paper fires, campfires, forest fires, and house fires. Yellow flames all. Air just can't flow in fast enough to make the fuels burn completely to carbon dioxide and water. If you don't believe that there are tiny particles of unburned carbon in a candle flame, just insert the blade of a table knife in the flame for a few seconds to catch them before they burn out. The blade will acquire a deep, velvety black coating of carbon. This carbon black is just about the blackest substance known and is used in inks. Gas grills and gas ranges, on the other hand, start out with a gaseous fuel, no vaporizing required. That makes it easy for the fuel to mix with lots of air so that the burning reaction can go full blast. Because the fuel is burning almost completely, we get a much hotter flame. And it's a clear, transparent flame, because no glowing carbon particles clutter it up. Want hotter yet? Why not mix pure oxygen, instead of air, with the fuel gas? After all, air is only about 20% oxygen. Glassblowers use a torch that mixes oxygen with natural gas, methane, to produce a flame temperature of about 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit, 1,600 degrees Celsius. A welder's oxyacetylene, oxygen plus acetylene gas, torch can reach about 6,000 degrees Fahrenheit, 3,300 degrees Celsius. Clear blue flames all, except when the torch is improperly adjusted so that the gas doesn't get enough oxygen to burn completely. Result, a yellow sooty flame. You didn't ask, but why should a hot, properly adjusted gas flame be blue instead of some other color? It has to do with the fact that atoms and molecules that are heated in flames can absorb some of the heat energy and then promptly spit it back out as light energy. Every substance has its own typical wavelengths or colors of light that it emits after being stimulated by the heat. Tech speak, every substance has its own unique emission spectrum. The propane or natural gas in your gas grill and the acetylene in the welder's torch are very similar. They are all hydrocarbons, compounds of carbon and hydrogen. It happens that hydrocarbon molecules emit many of their particular light wavelengths in the blue and green parts of the visible spectrum. Other kinds of atoms and molecules, if they were vaporized and burned, would impart their own particular colors to the flame. That's how colored fireworks are made. A whoosh is no big whoop. I usually buy my soda pop in 2-liter bottles, but with such a big bottle, keeping the leftovers alive and fizzy from one pizza to the next is a problem. Besides keeping the cap on, what else can I do to keep it from going flat? What about that gadget that you put on the bottle and pump up? Does it really work? Your objective is to keep as much carbon dioxide gas in the bottle as possible, because that's what the fizzy bubbles are made of. Keeping the bottle tightly stoppered certainly has to be your first line of defense. But, frankly, it won't help very much. There are many kinds of stoppers on the market. including that fancy pump-up job that you mention. It's a miniature bicycle pump that you screw onto the bottle, and then you pump a plunger to compress the gas inside the bottle. Sounds good, but unfortunately, it's a complete fraud. All it does is make you think your soda is livelier than it is. Let's see why. Soda fizzes when dissolved carbon dioxide gas emerges as bubbles. The gas wants desperately to escape from the liquid because the folks down at the bottling plant have pumped in much more carbon dioxide than would ordinarily dissolve under atmospheric conditions. As soon as you open the bottle, most of that excess gas escapes into the room, and there is absolutely nothing you can do about that. Your only problem is how to make the remaining gas stay in the liquid for as long as possible. Three things determine how much of a gas can remain dissolved in a liquid: the chemical reactions of the specific gas, the pressure, and the temperature. Reactions. Gases that react chemically with water will generally dissolve more readily than inactive gases, whose molecules have nothing to do but cruise aimlessly around in the water. Carbon dioxide is one of those gases that reacts. It forms carbonic acid, which adds that nice little pungent taste to soda, beer, and sparkling wine. Air, nitrogen, and oxygen doesn't react with water. As a result, carbon dioxide at room temperature is more than 50 times more soluble in water than nitrogen is, and more than 25 times more soluble than oxygen. Pressure. The effect of pressure is just what you'd expect. The higher the gas pressure above the liquid, the more gas will be pressed into the liquid. The way it works is that at higher pressures, there are more gas molecules flitting about per cubic inch in the space above the liquid, and more of them will therefore be diving each second into the liquid. Temperature. The effect of temperature is probably just the opposite of what you'd expect. The higher the temperature, the less gas will dissolve. Saying it another way, the colder the liquid is, the more gas it can hold. The reason for this is a little more involved than we want to get into right now, so we'll save it for later. But one example: at room temperature, water can hold only about half as much carbon dioxide as it can at refrigerator temperature. Our conclusions, then, are that in order to keep as much carbon dioxide dissolved in the soda as possible, we must keep the gas pressure high and the temperature low. Temperature is no problem. We'll just make sure it's good and cold before we open the bottle, and then we'll put the leftovers back in the refrigerator as soon as possible. But pressure is quite another matter. At the bottling plant, the carbon dioxide molecules were forced into the soda like a crowd of claustrophobes into an elevator. The instant we open the bottle, a frantic exodus takes place, and virtually all the carbon dioxide pressure goes off in one big whoosh. Once that happens, your soda is inevitably going to flatten. It's just a matter of time. But is there really nothing we can do about that? Can't we restore the pressure somehow, that we may live to belch another day? Enter the gadget hucksters. Just screw their gizmo onto the bottle, they say, pump the piston a few times, and there you are. Next time you open the bottle, you'll be treated to the biggest, most satisfying whoosh you ever heard. And you're supposed to think that your soda is factory fresh. But guess what? There isn't one more molecule of carbon dioxide in there than if you had simply screwed the cap on tight. You'd get the same big whoosh if there were nothing but plain water and air in the bottle. The gizmo is nothing but an expensive stopper. What you've pumped into the bottle is air, not carbon dioxide. Sure, there's a little carbon dioxide in the air, but it's only about 1 out of every 3,000 molecules. The escape of a gas from a liquid can be decreased only by putting more of that particular gas into the space above the liquid. The amount of carbon dioxide that will stay dissolved in the soda depends only on how many collisions take place between carbon dioxide molecules and the surface of the liquid. If you had pumped in carbon dioxide gas, that would be another story. But nitrogen and oxygen are simply irrelevant. Bottom line, keep it capped and keep it cold. It's especially important to keep the bottle tightly sealed while it is out of the refrigerator, because that's mainly when the carbon dioxide is emerging, due to the higher temperature. So pour what you want, cap the bottle, and put it right back in the fridge. But don't get your hopes up too high. You can slow down the exodus of carbon dioxide, but you can't stop it. And, oh, yes, whatever you do, never shake the bottle. That only speeds up the emergence of the gas. You didn't ask, but why does warm beer go flat? A larger amount of gas can dissolve in a liquid when it is cold than when it is hot. Or as a chemist would say, the solubility of a gas in a liquid increases with decreasing temperature. But that's how chemists talk. In practical terms, why does the carbon dioxide choose to leave the beer just because it is getting warmer? From everyday experience, you might expect that as the liquid gets warmer, it should be capable of dissolving more stuff, not less. You can dissolve more sugar in hot tea than in iced tea, can't you? Then why should gases be any different? The answer lies in the role that heat plays in the dissolving process. It can be a very complicated one. When a substance dissolves in water, its molecules separate from one another and disperse themselves throughout the water. Other changes may occur at the same time, depending on the substance that is dissolving. For example, the molecules might attach themselves to tight little clusters of water molecules, or they may react chemically with the water, or they may split into electrically charged fragments, or do other things too horrible to contemplate. All of these processes either use up or give off energy in the form of heat. So, heat plays an intimate and widely varying role in the dissolving of various substances. The net result is that some substances will eagerly absorb the extra heat in hot water and use it to dissolve more, while some substances will react negatively to the extra heat and dissolve less. In other words, some substances will be more soluble in hot water than in cold, and others will be less soluble in hot water than in cold. Even chemists can't always predict which way it will go for a given substance. In the case of gases, though, we can make a sweeping generalization. When gases dissolve in water, they all give off energy in the form of heat. You could say, and I will, that dissolving gases don't like heat. They are trying to get rid of it. So they will dissolve more readily in a cold, heat-absorbing environment like cold water. And they are discouraged from dissolving in a hot, heat-rich environment, like hot water. Try it. Let a glass of cold water stand around for a few hours, and as it warms up, you'll see bubbles of air forming on the walls of the glass. The air was dissolved in the cold water, but the warmer water can't retain that much air. It goes flat, just like beer. Iconoclastic. Elastic. Everybody knows that things expand when they're heated, but somebody wanted to bet me that there was a common substance around the house that will contract when heated. Should I have taken the bet? No, you were right to pass on that one. The common substance is rubber, stretched rubber. Most things expand when heated for a simple reason. The higher temperature makes the atoms or molecules move faster. They then need more elbow room, spreading farther apart on the average, and that makes the whole substance take up more space. But rubber can behave differently because of its oddly shaped molecules. They're like worms in a can, thin, squiggly-shaped chains tangled all together into a disorderly snarl. That is, until you stretch the rubber. When you stretch it, the chains are stretched out straighter, forced to line up along the direction of the stretch. But that is a very strained, unnatural state for them. You know that because you had to work to stretch them out that way, just as you would to stretch out a spring. As soon as you let go, the rubber molecules return to their compact, crinkled forms, and the rubber as a whole will snap back to its original shape. What has that got to do with the effects of heat? Well, if you heat the rubber while it is in its stretched-out molecule form, the heat-induced agitation of the molecules makes them pull in on their ends, which tends to decrease their length. A wriggling snake is a shorter snake. The rubber thus tries to revert as much as it can to its more compact form. It contracts. Try it. Cut a rubber band, at least a quarter inch wide, to make a strip rather than a loop. Use a tan rather than a colored rubber band. The colored ones generally aren't natural rubber. Tie a weight to one end of the strip and tack the other end to the edge of a shelf, letting the weight hang down freely. The weight should be heavy enough to stretch the rubber moderately. Now, heat the rubber band with a hairdryer. Watch carefully, and you'll see the rubber contract, pulling the weight up a bit higher. Barbette. Rubber can contract when heated. That's stretched rubber, remember. Rubber that isn't stretched will expand when heated, just like anything else. Beating the heat. How can the very same thermos bottle keep hot things hot and cold things cold, seemingly at our whim? To solve the problem, all you have to do is think of heat as a kind of liquid that flows only downhill from high temperatures to low temperatures. The thermos bottle acts like a dam that blocks the flow of heat. It won't let heat flow down from your hot coffee inside to the lower temperature air outside. But by the same token, it won't let the heat flow down from the outside air to your lower temperature iced tea inside. Another way of saying this is that the walls of the thermos bottle are a very effective heat insulator, a substance or arrangements of substances that retards the flow of heat. We're most familiar with using insulators to keep heat from flowing out of our warm bodies and houses into the cold outdoors. Ski jackets, sleeping bags, and attic insulation come readily to mind. But our refrigerators are also insulated. In this case, to keep heat from flowing in. Insulators work both ways. Heat, of course, isn't a liquid, even though it does flow from one place to another. It moves in three ways: by conduction, by convection, and by radiation. Let's take them one by one and see how a thermos container foils them all. Put a cool object in close contact with a warm one, and you know what will happen. The warm object surrenders some of its heat to the cool one, so that the cool one becomes warmer and the warm one becomes cooler. Some heat has been transferred, or conducted, from the warmer object to the colder one. But what is heat anyway? It is the agitation or movement of an object's molecules. The more vigorously its molecules are moving, the warmer it is. So when you place a warm object, having rapidly moving molecules, in close contact with a cooler object, having slowly moving molecules, some of the faster molecules will collide with the slower molecules, transferring some of their energy to the slower molecules and speeding, warming them up. That's conduction, direct molecule-to-molecule energy transfer. When you touch a hot frying pan handle, your skin molecules are speeded up by collisions with the frying pan's faster-moving molecules. When you touch an ice cube, your skin molecules lose some of their speed through collisions with the ice molecules. A thermos container hinders conduction because it has double walls with nothing, a vacuum, in between. Because there are no molecules in a vacuum to collide with, heat conduction can't take place through it. Convection is the process whereby heat is transferred from one place to another by the actual bulk movement of a heat-containing gas or liquid. You've heard people say that heat rises? What they really mean is that hot air rises, and along with it goes the heat it contains. That's convection. A convection oven is simply an oven with a fan in it that assists the circulation of hot air. In that case, the process is called forced convection. A thermos bottle hinders convection simply by being a closed container. Warm air can't pass through its walls. Any kind of closed container would stop convection. Finally, heat can be radiated from one place to another in the form of infrared radiation. These energy waves are emitted by warm objects. They fly through space and can be absorbed by cooler objects, transferring their energy to them and heating them up. A thermos container hinders infrared radiation by deflecting it with a mirror. The double walls of the container are silvered on their inner, vacuum-containing surfaces, so any infrared radiation that tries to get through from either direction is reflected right back to where it came from. If you think radiation isn't a serious contender for heat transmission, consider how you broil a steak underneath the heating element in an electric oven. Heat travels upward by convection, all right, but a lot of it also goes downward, and in all other directions, by radiation. No thermos container is perfect, of course. Some heat is always being conducted or radiated out of your hot coffee or into your iced tea. But the thermos slows down the heat transfer processes substantially, and your food or beverage stays hot or cold for hours, rather than minutes. Incidentally, the name thermos, it's just the Greek word for hot, started out as a trademark in 1904, but it became so widely used that it's now a generic term for any vacuum container. One manufacturer still uses it as a brand name, however. You didn't ask, but how does styrofoam work as an insulator? Unlike thermos, which has become a generic word, styrofoam is still struggling to retain its identity as a trademark. But nobody seems to be paying attention. People call all polystyrene foam products styrofoam anyway. The material is a good insulator because the plastic foam contains billions of trapped gas bubbles. Gases hinder heat conduction because their molecules are so far apart that they're very difficult for other molecules to collide with, either to give or to take away energy. The polystyrene plastic in between the bubbles is a good insulator too, because its molecules are so big that they can't move around much. The thin polystyrene foam boxes that restaurants pack your doggy bag food in are supposed to keep the food hot on your way home. Instead of staying really hot, though, the food is probably being kept at just the right temperature for bacteria to flourish. Then, when you get home, you put the whole box in the refrigerator for the next day's lunch. But the foam insulation may keep it at maximum spoilage temperature for another hour or so. Better to transfer the food into an uninsulated container before putting it in the refrigerator. Freeze! I've got you uncovered! I took a can of soda pop from the refrigerator, and the instant I opened it, it froze solid. What happened? The soda wasn't frozen as long as it was still in the refrigerator, because the refrigerator's temperature was warmer than its freezing point. But when you pulled the tab, you did two things. You released the pressure inside the can, and you lost some of the gas. For different reasons, each of these effects helped the liquid to freeze. Every liquid has a certain temperature at which it will freeze. Its freezing point. The freezing point of pure water is 32 degrees Fahrenheit, or 0 degrees Celsius. Impure water, water that has any kind of stuff dissolved in it, has a colder freezing point than pure water does. The more stuff is dissolved in the water, the colder its freezing point will be. Soda pop certainly has a lot of stuff dissolved in it. Sugars, flavors, and especially carbon dioxide gas. So it won't freeze until well below 32 degrees Fahrenheit. But as soon as you opened the can, the liquid lost some of its burden of dissolved carbon dioxide gas, which escaped from the liquid and went off into the air. Now containing less dissolved stuff, the liquid's freezing point becomes warmer than its own temperature from the refrigerator, and it dutifully freezes. Opening the can and releasing the pressure had another effect as well. Ice occupies more volume than liquid water does, so if you compress ice, it tends to revert to its smaller volume liquid state. It melts. Under the high pressure conditions in the closed can, the ice was repressed and remained liquid. But as soon as you released the pressure, the liquid water was free to expand into its higher volume form. Ice. Of course, this couldn't have happened unless the soda was already colder than its freezing point because it had already lost the gas. As if that weren't enough, there was a third effect. When you opened the can, the compressed carbon dioxide gas was able to expand. Whenever a gas expands, it cools. This extra cooling also contributed to the freezing. Either turn your refrigerator down, that is, turn the temperature up, or don't open the cans until they've warmed up a bit. You can wait. Getting hot in bed. Why do water beds have to have heaters? A few days after filling one, won't the water be just as warm as anything else in the room?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.